My mother taught me about medicine. If you don't stop crossing your eyes, they're going to freeze that way. Anybody ever heard that one? I heard the one about if you sit too close to the TV, you'll go blind and all that. If you sit too close to the TV now, you'll just go stupid.
Yeah.
My mother taught me how to be a contortionist. She said, will you look at the dirt on the back of your neck? My mother taught me to appreciate a job well done. She said, if you kids are going to kill each other, do it outside. I just finished cleaning. My mother taught me about genetics. She said, you're just like your father. And my mother taught me about logic. It's because I said so, that's why. How many ever run into one of those, huh? I want to talk this morning from the scriptures. In fact, if you'll turn to Matthew 15 and put your finger there, and then we're going to read also Luke or Mark's account of it. And I just want to read those two because it's just a couple of little incidences in those two verses that are a little different that I want to emphasize. I want to talk this morning about the faith of a mother and the faithfulness of our Savior. The faith of a mother. In fact, when I was looking at the scriptures, the highlighted verse says, at least in my Bible, a Gentile shows her faith. And that's true. This woman, we'll talk about the Syrophoenician woman, but I want to refer to her as a Syrophoenician mother. And the way that her faith went to work on behalf of a need, and I'll talk about that, but most of all I want to emphasize, and at the end of the service I want to play a song that has just been going through my heart and my mind for days now, because what a wonderful Savior we have. Amen?
Yeah.
Where would we be without Jesus? And every time I think about one of the old hymns we used to sing, you know, how marvelous, how wonderful. And my song shall ever be. How wonderful, how marvelous is my Savior's love to me. Now, one of the things that Satan wants to do is he always is trying to create an offense toward God by things that we experience. If you go through a difficult time, you go through a trial, and it doesn't seem like it's going to get over as quick. In fact, one of the challenges of my faith is that so often when I have been sick, I can pray and get quick, well quick, and then I go to a doctor and said, you know, there's a problem with you. You're human. And so I slapped her and said, no, that's not true. I mean, the truth is, we know about who we are in Christ. We often forget about who we are as human beings. That's why Jesus came. So that the power of the cross and the covenant of what he did on the cross secures our healing and our salvation and our deliverance. But Satan loves to take advantage of those times when we're down, when we don't see an answer to prayer as quickly as we like, and he wants to create an offense toward God. In fact, in Malachi chapter 3, and you'll be comforted to know I'm not talking about the tithing verse in Malachi, but there's this portion of scripture where the Lord says, the context is he's telling people, you know, you've robbed me, and they say, well, Lord, tell us how we ever robbed you. He said, well, you've robbed me by tithes and offerings. And it isn't that anybody can go and stick up God, but it's that when God has designed things to work for us where we sow and reap, that there's something about when we give, it gives God the opportunity to give back in abundance. Just like a kernel of corn ends up being a stalk of corn with thousands of kernels of corn. That's how God's created his kingdom to operate. A little seed sown becomes a mighty seed and mighty fruitfulness. But the people were complaining about God, and he said this in Malachi 3, your words have been harsh against me, says the Lord. Yet you say, what have we spoken against you? Well, he says, you have said it's useless to serve the Lord God. And what profit is it that we have kept his ordinances and that we have walked as mourners before the Lord of hosts? So, now we call the proud blessed, and those who do wickedness are raised up, and they even tempt God to get away with it. And the psalmist said, many are they that say of me, there's no help for him in God. My tears have been my food day and night while they are continually saying to me, where is your God? We are being taunted all the time by the enemy when there are things that don't turn out the way we want. Or we're believing for something, and often, unfortunately, we are in such a microwave world that we expect everything to be done quickly and quietly. I want this now, I want patience, and I want it now. Yeah. How many have found that doesn't work? I never pray for patience. It's one of those gifts that God just gives you. So look at these portions of Scripture. First in chapter 15 of Matthew, beginning at verse 21. Then Jesus went out from there and departed to the region of Tyre and Sidon. And behold, a woman of Canaan came from the region and cried out to him, saying, have mercy on me, O Lord, son of David. My daughter is severely demon-possessed. And he answered her not a word. And his disciples came and urged him, saying, send her away, for she cries out after us. But he answered and said, I was not sent except to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. And then she came. Get this. She's heard this. Then she came and worshipped, fell at his feet and worshipped him and said, Lord, help me. But he answered and said, it's not good to take the children's bread and throw it to the little dogs. And she said, but yes, Lord, yet even the little dogs eat the crumbs which fall from their master's table. Then Jesus said unto her, woman, great is your faith. Let it be to you as you desire. And her daughter was healed from that very hour. And I want you to quickly look over in Mark's account of this, where he says in verse 24, Then he arose and went to the region of Tyre and Sidon, and he entered a house. This is a key thing right here. He wanted no one to know it. This next line is powerful, but he could not be hidden. Would you say that with me? But he could not be hidden. Now, that's not my sermon right there, but I'll tell you, when I heard that, I thought, that's my Lord. That's my Lord. No matter what's going on, God cannot be hidden when you're seeking for him with all your heart. For a woman whose young daughter had an unclean spirit heard about him, and she came and fell at his feet. The woman was a Greek, a Syrophoenician by birth, and she kept asking him to cast the demon out of her daughter. But Jesus said to her, let the children be filled first. Everyone notice the word first. Would you say that with me? First. That's important, because in a moment you're going to know why that's important. Let the children be filled first. For it is not good to take the children's bread and throw it to the little dogs. I love that verse. I think of puppies. All right. And she answered and said to him, yes, Lord, yet even the little dogs under the table eat from the children's crumbs. And he said to her, for this saying, go your way. The demon has got out of your daughter. And when she had come to her house, she found the demon was gone, and her daughter was lying on the bed, peaceful. So I want to quickly point out a couple things. Are you with me this morning? Say amen.
Amen.
I want to talk just briefly about the Syrophoenician mother and her faith. I want to just point out again the very simple thing in the first few verses, the need that brought her to Jesus. And then most importantly, I want us to focus on the fact that there were obstacles that she faced. And seeing how she faced those obstacles and how her response was to those obstacles. And by the way, anybody ever here faced an obstacle when you prayed? Anybody gone through any trials or difficulties?
Yes.
Let me put my glasses on to see if there's any honest people out here. All right. And finally, Jesus' commendation and his response. The real theme of this message this morning is the kind of faith that prevails. And I especially want to point it out because when I think about this mother's faith and her, I think about several mothers in our church who, when their children, I think every mother that's here today can remember a time when your kids were really ill. You maybe didn't have access to a doctor, or it wasn't convenient to get a child to an urgent care or something like that. And there you were in the middle of the night dealing with a little boy that couldn't breathe, or a little daughter who had kidney disease, and you're facing some really heavy obstacles. And My heart was stirred when I was reading this about how many times the faith and faithfulness of a mother will fight a battle. And I mean, I always think about, you know, you don't mess with mama's babies. You know, if you want to get someone in your face, pick on their kids, you know. I mean, I've told you the story about the time someone tried to jump up and attack my son at a basketball game. Anybody remember this story?
Yes.
And those that don't remember it, you're going to get another shot of it, Paul. This guy came up and acted like he was going to beat up on my son. My little wife jumped up between that guy and my son and said, "Back off!" And I'm in the bleachers going, "Who is that woman?" Because there's no way I could have handled that guy. But I'll tell you what, after she did that, the guy just kind of walked away stunned, you know. You don't mess with my babies, you know. But I want you to understand that sometimes we face issues where there's a response that we feel like is silence, or that there's a no, or that somehow God has not answered the way we want or as quick as we wanted. But I want you to see that wherever we have these trials, we can face the trials in faith and not be denied what God says is our heritage. So let's talk about this woman. She was a Gentile. She was considered by the Jewish culture a dog. Not dogs like a little dog, like they were considered scavengers because they were outside the covenant. Now, this is an interesting thing that this woman would seek Jesus out because she has a dire need. This is the other thing about moms. Moms are the most unselfish people in the world. I mean, my wife, I've watched her say that if there's not enough food, she would go without food so the kids could be fed. How many have done that? Let me see your hands. Yeah. We will do whatever we can to put our children first. But this woman, though she was outside of the covenant of promise, pursues Jesus because of a desperate, urgent need. Her daughter is grievously tormented by an evil spirit, a demon. So she is, number one, outside covenant. Number two, she's desperate. And she's going to seek Jesus out because no matter what your need is, the scripture says, you may think that you can't find him, but the Bible says that Jesus cannot be hid. When you're hungry and needing an answer, he will be found. Someone say amen. But Jeremiah 29 says, you will find him when you seek him with all your heart. I will be found if you. I have a message for you. It's a hope to give you a desired end, a future and a hope. And how many times situations come up where we feel hopeless, sought the Lord, and seems like nothing's happening. I want you to notice that she recognized who Jesus was. She had heard about what was going on. She had heard about it in a foreign land. Jesus constantly had to deal with the Pharisees and the religious people who wanted to fight against this Savior who came to save, heal, and deliver. And he actually went away from his own people into a land where he would be left alone, but he could not be hidden because there was a woman looking for the one who had the answer for him. And she called out to him, Son of David, which indicates that she knew that this was not just any man, that this was Son of David, this was the Messiah. So she knew she had heard rightly, and she knew she found the one who could make the difference, and she believed that he could help her. That's number two. Number three. Her cry was not for herself, but for her daughter. This is the other thing about moms that are so amazing, is that they're so selfless. They put their kids first in everything. I am so thankful because my mom had to work, go to school and work as a teacher and to provide the season when my dad was out of the picture, working out of state, and was not home for months at a time, and mom had to pick up the pieces, as it were, pick up the slack that was there because dad was not always there. And the idea of making sure that the kids got their needs met. Though Jesus needed a time away from the crowd, he went into a place where he thought he'd be alone, but he could not be hidden. I love that. Say that with me. He could not be hidden. And he's not going to be hidden this morning the Holy Spirit, and I want you to agree with me right now, Holy Spirit, reveal Jesus today like we've never seen him before. Lord, reveal to us this morning the power of having faith properly placed in the one who's able to do exceedingly abundantly above all we ask or even think. Know the thoughts of the Lord. This is one thing about, you know, it's amazing, the reputation that she knew about Jesus was that she knew that he could answer the impossible things. And that's why for me, when we say Jeremiah 29, we know God's thoughts. Do you know God's thoughts for you? Or are you one of those people who constantly thinks that somehow God is out to get you? I mean, you'd be shocked how many people I've talked to who think that somehow, that if God really had his way, he'd kick us right off the planet. Because we recognize so many faults and failures and sins and But how could he ever really love us? Well, you can't put on God or on Jesus what is some of our human qualities, because he loves to the uttermost. So I want you to notice again this mother's passion. She knows if she calls on the Lord that he will hear. But then she faced some obstacles. How many have ever faced obstacles in your prayer life? But if you're desperate enough, you won't let any obstacle get in your way. And I know. Listen, I've knelt beside the bed of my kids. I've knelt beside my loved ones, and members of this church body that were facing death. And I've knelt beside them and I prayed and I believed that God was going to show up. And you know what? I'll never believe, no matter what the outcomes, that God did not show up. I'll never believe that. Because at the worst thing the enemy can do you, Jesus is there, if you're his, to capture you and take you away. But I love this fact that Jesus could not be hid, and this woman pursued, this mother, though she knew, and she finds this out in the conversations, she finds out that she's not necessarily welcomed. But the first thing that challenges us is that when she cries out to the Lord, and I had to struggle with this a little bit, but then I realized that behind everything that happens, everything that Jesus does, there's a reason behind it. He's never out to make you feel like he's not listening. He always hears the cry of the humble. He's always near the heart of those who've been crushed. So the first thing he has to deal with is the cry of this woman who has no right to really cry out. But this is where you see the difference between religion and Jesus. But his first response is sometimes puzzling to people, because the scripture says in Matthew that as she cries for help, he is utterly silent. He answers her not a word. Now this is where it gets intensely personal. How many have ever prayed and felt like God was completely silent? Let me see. Yeah. Just in case you want God to move, you've got to be honest. When you feel like those times where I've prayed, it just doesn't seem like things are happening. So she doesn't answer. Now, how many people would have said, I've cried out, and nothing's happening, I've given up. And I want to challenge people this morning. If you're one of those who have been contending for a miracle for a long time, for a healing, for a deliverance, or whatever it is, and it seems to not have happened, where has your faith ended up? Has your faith ended up shipwrecked? Or has your faith been strengthened by the fact that because you know who God is, there is no way that he is not hearing the cry of your heart?
Amen.
The Lord hears the cry of the humble. He resists the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. By the way, for that moment, he's silent. Now, he's going to say something in a moment. But before he does, Mr. Helpy Helperton disciples, they chime in because they consider her just a common beggar. So their solution is just do what we do with beggars. Give her something and get her out of our face. Tell her to leave. Send her away. I wonder sometimes if in our discipleship we do the same thing. It's easier to send someone away than to contend for what's going on in their life and see the grace of God through you minister the power and love of Jesus Christ to meet the need. Do you know, church, I could go off on this and spend a lot of time, but we have not been sent here to wait for Jesus to come back and finish everything he started. He said, when I go away, I will send another just like me, the Holy Spirit, the Comforter. And when he comes, he will teach you and show you everything that I have done and everything I've said. And then he says, as the Father has sent me, I am sending you. In other words, you do what he did because he commanded us to do it. Yes. Heal the sick. Cleanse the leper.
Yes.
Raise the dead. And everybody kind of goes, oh, Pastor, don't say that one. But the Christ who called us and commissioned us said, you go to those areas where it seems the most hopeless, where the need seems beyond our ability. Folks, I'm telling you, any ministry that just leans on the arm of flesh will fail. I have nothing in my flesh that can offer anything to anybody. All I have is what Jesus put within me and what you have, Jesus, put within you. You have this treasure in an earthen vessel, that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us. It's all about Jesus being lifted up and glorified. It's about not only bringing glory to him, but you know something? God is a God of glory. But he loved us so much, he wanted to manifest that glory to us and seeing us saved, healed, and delivered. This is the gospel. Not that you hear something, but that you experience something that breaks every bondage in your life, that heals every sickness and disease. This is the gospel. Man, if you don't help me, I'll get out of wind here and fall over. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
Not that I fall over, but that you're getting an agreement with me. I got some juice there to keep going. Send her away. The disciples were no help. They were discouraging. She overheard that. Send her away. She's nothing but a nuisance. We've got stuff to do, people to see, places to go. And then Jesus does this astonishing thing. He says, this is crazy. He gives his mission statement right in the earshot of this woman. What was his mission statement at that moment? He said, I am not sent except to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Can you imagine how this must have jarred the faith of a woman who says, I'm a Gentile, I'm considered a dog, I cried out, there was no answer. Now these disciples, as they're so-called, want to get me out of the way of Jesus. I'm glad Jesus didn't say, send her away. I hope we as disciples will never take that attitude. I don't know what to do with them. Send them away. Why do you think God has CCR here? We're not here to do anything in our own power. We're here to operate in the commission and the ability God has given us to make a difference in lives. I'm more and more convinced that while God has the power to instantaneously deliver people, I think that he's looking for people who will listen and see into the need and recognize not everything is so simple that you can slap someone on the head, you know, and say, be healed, and not realize that somewhere in the midst of that brokenness, God wants to discern what that is and call that thing out so the person who's been in bondage and demonized and broken can find a deliverance in the fact that Jesus knows the trauma that brought you to that brokenness. Amen. Jesus came to heal the brokenhearted. Sorry.
Amen.
He has come to set the captives free. This is the Christ we serve. So now she has heard this thing, and Jesus has said, my commission doesn't include you. So now she adds to her dilemma, I really have no authority or qualification to be here. I'm excluded, and here's the master who I know is the Messiah, but evidently the Messiah doesn't relate to me. Now that would be enough to be discouraging. Would that be enough for you to turn around and say, well, maybe another day, maybe another Messiah? But she knows there's only one, the Son of David, the Messiah. He's the only one who can heal and deliver. Today's disciples are so powerless and insensitive. They're too often eager. And I didn't mean to say that again, but I'm saying it again. Too eager to send people away. So here's a woman who's been dismissed, disqualified, despised, denied, and discarded. But what does she do? She has this kind of faith that we know at the end of this story is a faith that Jesus admired. And whenever you look at a story in the Bible where Jesus says something about the faith of the person, it's always a commendation that we should take note of. Because you remember the centurion who came and said, "Heal my servant." And Jesus said, "I'll come, I'll heal him." And he said, "No, no, no. I'm a man under authority. I'm a man of authority. All you have to do is say the word." Dear God, help us. All you need to do, Jesus. I, as a centurion, I say to this man, "You go," and he goes. Jesus, you don't have to come to my house. All you have to do is speak the word, and that servant will be healed and made whole. And Jesus said, "Man, I've not seen faith like this anywhere." How many want to be in that number? How many want to have that faith? I know there are people today who get sidetracked with saying, "Well, you didn't have enough faith to be healed." And I know there are people that jump on that as though that's the message of faith. It's not the message of faith. The message of faith is, when you have faith, deal with the unbelief that wants to creep in and disqualify what you know to be true, that's forever written in this eternal word of covenant, the living word of God. So not only has she felt like she's been discarded, but Jesus says another thing, and this is found in a couple places in Scripture. And a lot of people don't like this when you hear this. Jesus actually said in Romans 1:16 that salvation is of the Jews first. Why is that? Isn't because God excludes everybody else, but because Jesus was Jewish. And because Jesus brought us in to him, we didn't do the Jews a favor. They brought us in because Jesus brought us in and grafted us in to the vine. But he says this: let the children first be filled. Now, that could be really like preferential treatment. But Jesus is not talking about preferential treatment. He said, because, and by the way, Jesus also says this over in the book of John, where he says, salvation is of the Jews. Because that's how God promised salvation is through his chosen people. Aren't you glad that Jesus went to the cross for Jew and Gentile alike? He died for everyone, and he died for each one. But such was the religion, or the spirit of religion in that day, that Gentiles were considered wild dogs, unclean scavengers. But when Jesus is talking to this woman, he says, let the children first be filled. And you know, I imagine that this mother thought, if there's someone first, someone has to be second. If they're first, that doesn't mean I'm excluded. That means the provision of God came through that place first so that everyone else coming to the table could be fed. I love that, in fact, the original language, I was glad for this translation, that every time Jesus is referring to the children or the dogs, he uses the term the little ones, the little dominion, the original language. So it's a very tender, tender heart. Jesus isn't saying what people around him say. He's not saying they're scavengers and dogs, they don't deserve to be fed. He is saying, listen, in fact, let me back up. He doesn't say this at first. What happens is this mother boldly, but not irreverently, agrees. And I want to tell you what's very important about this. When you're a person of faith and something sounds adverse or exclusionary, discarding, rather than argue with the mindset of religion that says, oh, yeah, the children first, that means there's not enough for us. But she says this, and I love this about this woman. She says, that is true. Don't argue with Jesus. He's Lord. Right. So he says, that's true, Lord. What you said is true. Let the children be fed first. But then she says this amazing thing that takes Jesus right at his heart. Because, by the way, everything that Jesus is putting her through, as it were, is to draw out from her the answer And that is the kind of faith that will not be denied, no matter what the psyche says, no matter what the religious system says, but only what she hears from the Master. And what she knows about the Christ she's heard about is that everywhere he goes, people are being healed, saved, and delivered. I've come to that one. That's the one I've come to. I've not come to those disciples. I've come to Jesus because I know that he will answer the cry of my heart. Now, after she hears all these things, you'd think that she'd just kind of bow her head and back out and say, but you know what she does? After she agrees with Jesus, she falls at his feet, Matthew 15:25, in worship. Let me tell you what I have had to do, and I know what I've been experiencing is nothing compared to a lot of what people have experienced in sickness. You know, as I get older, I realize that I can't bounce back. I bounce better now because I'm fatter. But I don't bounce back. Now you're distracting me. I can't remember what it was. That's how I'm bouncing back. Having to get in agreement with something that is true, but realizing, Lord, it may be true that children eat first. I may be getting old, but the one who created me is the one who can repair me. And he doesn't have to go to a junkyard to find parts. He's a creator, and he will do what he says he'll do. So she falls in humility at his feet, and she worships him. And listen, folks, many, many times this week, and when I was having difficulty breathing and couldn't sleep, and I could feel my heart fluttering, and that's an ugly bunch of stuff to think about. And in those times, I would get up and I'd go out and get a cracker and some grape juice, and I'd stand in my kitchen and say, this body was broken for me. Amen. And this cup established forever the covenant of my healing. And Jesus, even though I don't agree with why Job said it, what he said was true. Though God slay me, yet will I trust him. Amen. Though God slay, he's not my enemy and he will not slay me. But if that were the case, I will trust him. And I know that my Redeemer lives. Amen. I know my Redeemer lives. And I will see him one day in my flesh, though the canker worms may devour me. That's an ugly thought. But I will see him. Oh, you know, I haven't raised my voice that much in about 2 months. So keep praying. She falls down at his feet, and she says, after she's worshiped, says, Lord, it's true everything you've said. But most of all, she's saying, but you, Lord, are true. So help me. Please help me, Lord. Undeterred by the reference to throwing bread to dogs, little dogs, she's not offended. She doesn't argue. The facts of the covenant qualifications don't dissuade her. Yes, Lord, what you said is true. But even the puppies eat the crumbs that fall from the master's table. I want to ask you something. The bread goes to the children. And you know, when you sit at a table, I've had dogs, and I always love them. I don't know how they get so fat, because Wendy seems to think that I'm feeding, but I think our table has a hole in it. But my dogs are always, they always gather around me, and I go, that's not fair. You're giving me away. Now grandma thinks that maybe thinks I'm the one that's feeding, and they're going, you're the one feeding, you know. Good dog, get away from me. You know. But it's just, even the little puppies can come and eat with the leftover. It's amazing to me that the crumbs are enough to heal a little girl who's demon-possessed. And what we're talking about, not the little crumbs, we're talking about the fact that what falls from the table of the Lord's people is enough to heal, save, and deliver. And by the way, Jesus does not offer us crumbs. So this mother's response is humble, worshipful. She's resigned. She's resigned to the fact that, Lord, what ultimately, whatever happens, you're the Lord. But because she's driven by love, and don't ever forget this, Jesus is driven by love for her. So that love she knows in him makes her confident, and she's constant and persevering And it becomes even more earnest. And it reminds me of this, and I want to say this to anyone this morning who's contending for the miraculous. You may have everything in the world stacked against you. You may have your age against you, a disease that's progressed too long. And I tell you what, as I thought about this morning, I thought about my brother Jesus. I thought about my brother Jack, who's recovering from triple bypass. I could not help but think about Giovanni and a mother who knew more of the medications that her daughter got than the nurses who cared for her daughter. When she'd go in to say what was going on with medications, she could tell the doctor, no, we do this, 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 and this. That I know, because it's my wife, my little daughter's life depended on me knowing what that is. And I thought about those who've done the things in the natural that were loving, and the things that you do because it's what you do as a loving parent or a mother. But I want to step further this morning. And you'll pardon me if I sound intense on this. But when did we stop believing for a miracle?
Amen.
When did we stop believing for a miracle?
Amen.
We didn't stop when my brother Steve was dying. We didn't stop. We didn't stop when Linda Hill was dying. We didn't stop because we knew that no matter how bad it got, at any moment, the breath of life could come back and that person could be raised up. And when they went home, it wasn't because we stood around saying God failed. When they went home, we said even in death we have the victory because Jesus is the Lord of life and death. Amen, somebody. Anybody getting this?
Yes.
I want you to get it because don't stop believing. And by the way, that's not a phrase from a political campaign 10 years ago. It's from the scriptures. Don't stop believing. Put your faith out there. And where your faith you placed, and if you recognize there's something that hinders, cry out as that one did to the Lord and said, I believe, but help thou my unbelief. I want every last vestige of anything of my flesh or my mind that would stand between the miracle working power of God. I'm telling you, what God's looking for in this last day is people who will do what Elijah did. Elijah faced a wicked king and called down the judgment of God so there was no rain on the land for 3.5 years. He told Ahab, you're the problem, buddy. You're the problem. There came a day when God told Elijah to pray again that there would be rain. And the Bible says in 1 Kings 18:42 that Elijah went to the mountain and he put his head face between his knees. James 5 says, if anyone's sick, let him call the elders of the church. Let them pray, anoint with oil and pray, for the prayer of faith shall save the sick. And the effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. And Elijah was a man of like passions, but he prayed and prayed again, and God sent the rain. I want to tell you something. Sometimes you pray, and as Elijah said to his servant, go out and check the clouds. What do you see? That's clear as a bell. 7 times he goes out and finally comes back and says, well, ain't much, but there's a cloud about the size of a man's hand. And I always like this paraphrase phrase. Get ready, pal, because I hear the sound of abundance of rain. Go tell Ahab to get on his horse and start riding before it's impossible, because the rain will stop him. But here's Elijah, who's just a man like you and I. And he so believes in the power of prayer and of the God who has called him, that he gets in that position, by the way, and I understand this to be true. I've never been able to manage all the way through the birth process when my wife was giving birth. There came a point where there was a lot of shouting and crying that I had to step out. But I remember hearing that the face goes between the legs as they push to give birth. And sometimes, folks, we could give birth to a miracle, but we stop short of the travail in prayer. Not because God's trying to make us suffer, but because we are opposed by an adversary who wants us to give up too soon. And I'm telling you, folks, it's always too soon to quit. Let the children be filled. All right, that's fine. But Lord, your word says that there's more than enough at the table of the Lord. She makes such a tremendous impact on Jesus that he says to her, what you've said gives you the right to go and receive the blessing that you desired. In other words, your confession of faith gives you the right to go home to a daughter completely healed and delivered. I know there are people who probably say, well, you know, and I think too oftentimes, Christians, we forget that these are not little stories that we tell our children at night so they go to sleep and imagine what it's like to be Superman. But these are truths in the scripture where God says, this is who I am and this is how I work. What miracle, what thing have you given up on? And I'm going to put us all in the context of being Jesus' church, a model mother, who when we see a need, that we move beyond our selfish concerns and say, I will spend the extra time in intercession, and supplication, and prayer. I will bow before the Lord in worship, and I will cry out to him because I know he will hear me. Knowing this, and I want to come back to this important thing, Jesus is not trying to gaff this woman off. He's trying to pull out of her the kind of miracle that only God can do. It is that word of faith, and the Bible says, faith is the victory that overcomes the world. When that faith is placed firmly and unalterably upon the authority of the scriptures and the word of Jesus and the understanding that those who know their God shall be strong and not quit. I'm praying every day for miracles in this church.
Yeah.
I want to see a doctor say to Jesus, you have to put up with the fish filler for a while because we're not going to put you on dialysis for another year. I'm waiting for the doctor to say, you know, Giovanni had only one kidney and the one we left in there that was dead has suddenly come to life.
Yeah.
So don't tempt me. Don't tease me. God is not a teaser. And listen, if it never happened, it doesn't diminish God. But why not believe? You say, well, what if I pray and it doesn't happen? What if you pray and it does? I love this Christ because I know the Savior wants to do stuff.
Amen.
He died for us. He wants to heal us.
Amen.
He does not disqualify us. And it's time, by the way, disciples, all of you hear me? Stop being powerless because of a system that told you that those miracles went away when the Bible was completed. Those miracles did not go away, and they still are there for the claiming.
Yes.
And never believe that the silence that in your ear from the Lord is not followed by the lie of the enemy who says he doesn't hear. I'm telling you, he does hear the cry of your heart. Demons must obey. Demons must obey. Be like David who said, I cried out to the Lord and said, Lord, answer me quickly. How many of us want the answer to come quickly? And that's what gets us in trouble. We want it now. How soon do you want this? Yesterday. I want to be the person with the kind of faith that this mother had. That with all the arguments that the enemy put on me to say, you don't have enough faith, you don't have this, you don't have that. And besides that, God's just kind of ticked at you today. And never believe those lies. Amen? Now, before we go this morning, I asked Mikey to dial up, and I think, can you get that on a video with Ernie Hans? If it's not, don't worry about that, because I want you to hear this song, because all day yesterday I played it till Wendy came and shut the door. Because it's a song by Ernie Hans called, Oh, What a Savior. And I want us to hear that, and I want us to worship, and if it gets up there, great. If it doesn't, the soundtrack's all I really need. But as I was sitting in my office and thanking the Lord for the healing, though it's been slower than I wanted. And there's been time I'm waiting for an answer and I didn't hear anything. But I know God is faithful.
Yes.
I know he's faithful.
Yes.
And this song keeps coming to mind. And I'd like this to kind of be our benediction before we go. If you can get it, Mikey, any way you can. Ernie Hobbs and Signature Sound redid this song about a year ago. And I happen to be a Southern Gospel, lover of Southern Gospel music. And country music. And because country music's of God. No. All music's of the Lord. So everybody stop bugging me, all right? But I want you to listen to this whenever you can do it. Yeah. What? Oh, okay, great.
I have the audio, but I can't hear it.
All right. Mikey, thank you so much, our worship leader and our technical guy. Amen. Thank you. By the way, while we're doing that, he's getting that set up, I want to thank Randy Vaughn, Pastor Randy, for his, not filling in, but his taking on the next phase of whatever needs to be done while we're here, and covering before the front porch and all that. And Susan, where's Susan? Yeah, there she is, back in the back row. Backsliders row. That's not true. For all that she did, covering everything, I want to thank you all for that and for the team and all they've done and everybody that worked in the front porch. So when we're ready, let's give it a shot. I want you to hear the words of this song. Just turn it up loud.
I'm not afraid.
clap with you. What a Savior! Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Man, I tell you what, that's why I listened to about 10 times yesterday, because there's nothing like my wonderful Savior.